Praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We are so grateful for another opportunity and chance to come and to worship together. Corporate worship is a blessing, amen? That where we can come and fellowship and lean on each other, depend on each other, and more than anything, depend on God. Amen? We thank God just for allowing us to come through another week without any hurt, harm, or danger. And even if we did experience that, we're still here. Amen? God is great and greatly to be praised. And we do appreciate him for just being in our lives. How many are thankful for just another day to be in the land of the living? Hallelujah. Let's give him a hand praise. Hallelujah. He deserves all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. Hallelujah. We are blessed to be here, and we shouldn't take it for granted. So at this time, we are going to open up with prayer. We're going to call on Sister Mercedes if she would come and lead us in prayer. And then we're going to ask Mr. Minister Darnetta if she would come with the scripture after that. Let's receive them by saying amen.
Amen.
Oh, praise God, everybody. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. So I'm just going to open up with some scripture and go into prayer. And I want to go into Psalms 91. It says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress and my God. In him I will trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from thy snare of the follower and the noisome of pursuers. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings thou shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid of the terror by night, nor the arrow that fleeth by day. Thank you, Lord. And I just, right now, Lord, I thank you, and I go right into you, because you are my secret place, dear Lord. So this is, the church is your secret place, and I thank you, dear Lord. We can never say thank you enough, dear God. So we thank you for your secret place, to be covered by your wings, dear God, and to be covered by your strength and your shield. Thank you, dear Lord. We just pour it today into you, and we give you all the praise and all the glory, dear Lord. We anoint this word that's coming from Pastor John Lee today, that ears have not heard and eyes have not seen what you're going to do, and the victory that's going to come this week, right now. And we, you know, everyone's heart today, and everything that everyone bears, dear Lord. So we just give that all to you. We don't have to say it out loud. You already know, dear God. And we thank you for being the all-knowing God, dear Lord. We thank you for right now for our children that you're going to bring up and raise up, dear God, that you're going to do it all for your glory and your victory. It is already done in the name of Jesus, dear Lord. We know it because it's your word, dear God. So we just give it all to you in your precious name and lay it at your feet. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Sister Mercedes, for that beautiful prayer. I'm going to read Psalms chapter 1, the very first chapter. Can everybody please stand for the word? Psalms 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like a chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We praise God for the prayer and for the scripture. There's a little reading I wanted to share with you. I was gifted a devotional from one of my coworkers, and every day, as you know how devotionals work, there's something that you can meditate on and think on. And the one that I read was about rest, revival, and renewal. How many know that we need rest, revival, and renewal? And it says, may this season for you be one of rest, revival, and renewal. May you experience the rest of God in your most trying circumstances, and as a result, find peace and bear fruit where there's only been angst and thorns. May you experience a personal revival that changes how you pray, when you say, and where you put your name and time. And may you experience such soul renewal that even the old things in your life feel new. God doesn't make new things nice. He makes new things. Amen?
Amen.
Trust him and do a brand new work in you in the days ahead. God is able to make the old things new. Amen?
Amen.
He is a good God. Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. So he's a God that is faithful, and he's the same. He never changes. Amen?
Amen?
He's immutable. He's omnipresent. He's omnipotent. He's everywhere. He's all-powerful. And I praise God just to know him. Amen? And the pardon of our sins. He's a forgiving God, and he is faithful. We're going to take a few minutes before our praise team comes, or before maybe some words of encouragement. We're going to do meet and greet. So if there's someone you don't know, or even someone you do know, go and shake their hand, elbow bump, fist pump, and encourage them. Amen?
Amen.
Along their way. Amen. Amen. At this time, we're going to have Bishop Lindsay Abram to come and offer us some encouraging words. Amen. Let's receive him by saying amen.
Amen.
Greetings to all of you. Wait a minute. I think I was a little too close to the mic. All that popping and carrying on. But we're so glad to have all of you. And one thing I might say is God is good.
Yes,
we do honor him and we love him. Honor Pastor John and Lady Lynetta, Elder Chester, and ministers out there. Amen. And our guests, we're so glad to have you. Amen. I don't like to use visitors, but I say guests. You are special. And we serve a special God today. He is love, caring, and kind. And I noticed that we've been having funerals, homegoing services, memorial services. And what I'm led to say the short time I'm up here is to be encouraged. In the book of Thessalonians, Paul was writing to the church at Thessalonica. Evidently, some of the members were concerned about those who had passed on. What would happen to them? And he wrote that, now if you believe that Jesus died and rose again, when the Lord comes, those loved ones will be with him. And we will see our loved ones again. Now we know it hurts to lose loved ones. I remember when my dad passed away, and my mom, she lived to get in her 90s. She lived longer than dad. And they were both saved, and that was the good part. Amen. However you miss your loved ones, those especially who raised you, were responsible for you going to school, getting clothes, and eat food on the table.
Yes.
And so it doesn't bother me a lot, but I miss them.
Yes.
And time has a way of bringing about a healing. And especially when we know what the word says about our loved ones, it brings consolation. And then I had my brother, J.W., he was older than I was. He passed, I think back in 94, 95, I believe Dad passed in 85, Jay passed about 10 years after Dad. And then Stevie, I think, was the next, the youngest son. My brother, Steve, he was born October the 20th. I was born October 21st. One day between our birthdays. But I was able to eulogize him. And I preached, life is but a vapor. Over in James. We're here, then we could be gone.
Amen.
But our hope is in the Lord.
Yes.
And when we go, we will be with him.
Hallelujah.
And your loved ones will be with him.
Yes.
And so we don't weep as others who have no hope. But we know as long as they were saved, knew the Lord, we will see them again. We will see them again.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So I'm just here to give you some encouraging words. J.W., Stevie. Then I think it was Iris. And then Willie. Out of seven, there's three of us left. Lil, Joe, and myself. And so, appreciate your loved ones. Stick together. Check on them. Do things together. Don't leave them off to themselves. I'm reminded of Brother Johnny Mac Brown, Brother Brown. And he lived out, like you're going out 67 and you make a right. He lived way out there. And they found him dead. And I knew him, I knew the family. And so check on your loved ones, hallelujah. Amen. Because we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. But it's in the hands of the Lord.
Amen.
And all of you appreciate life. Appreciate God who is life. And that eternal life in him is deposited in us. So if we go to sleep, we shall rise again.
Amen.
No grave will be able to hold us down. This body is just a temple. But we're a spirit with a soul, and our body is our house. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And we're going to get a new body.
Amen.
A body that will not cry. Amen. A body that will not decay. A body like the Lord. Hallelujah. Are you glad about it? Hope beyond the grave. Elder Jackson and Anderson, Elder C.L. Jackson, he used to sing a song. Ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. Elder Anderson would sing that too. So, just stick together, love one another, and we have hope. If in this life only we have hope, we're all men most miserable. But now is Christ risen from the dead. And because he rose, we shall rise again. Amen. Saints and friends, we have hope in the Lord. Hallelujah. Don't be discouraged. He's soon to come.
Hallelujah.
He's going to get his bride. You see, in the biblical times when a man was going to get married, he's at his father's house, and he would build on to that house for his bride. And I could see why the Lord said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I'm going to prepare a place for you. If I go again, I'll come. And you see you under myself. That's why I'm doing you also.
Hallelujah.
And the way you know, and Thomas said, Lord, we know not the way. And he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. So Jesus is the way.
Oh, yeah.
Hallelujah. Aren't you glad about it, Elder Chester?
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, so I just want to leave a few encouraging words to you today. And I think about my siblings that have gone on. I look to see him again. Stevie, there was a time I wanted to lead him to the Lord, but he wasn't ready. Then I asked him again. He was ready.
Amen.
I took him through a salvation prayer. He accepted the Lord as his Savior. Iris had some health problems over there, and she was in the Ohio State University Hospital. She accepted the Lord, but I believe it was Bridget. I was going to tell Bridget, you know, take her to the Sabbath. But I ended up doing it. I eulogized her. But her service was more joyous. She was cremated, but we had a service, Bridget's church. And you know what? Iris, see, she had Debbie and Timmy when she was staying. And I think Bridget, too, staying with Mom and Dad on Penn, North Penn Street. So I knew things about those children, my nieces and nephews. And I'll tell you why it was joyous. When Bridget was young, she's a nurse now, she would cry where it looked like her breath was gone. And ours would blow into her mouth. And I used a text with Elijah when the youngster died, and he put his mouth to that youngster's mouth in the heat, and he came alive. That's what I used. And when Tim was just a little boy, he was in a box in the street, and Chan Robinson was his name. The praise team's getting ready, and I'm going to get ready to get out of your way. Let me tell you about Tim. He was in the middle, in Penn Street, and this truck ran up, didn't even hurt him. And I told him about that. I told him about Bridget. And Debbie, Willie had a friend, Donzel Wells. And right in front of the house, Donzel and Willie, and he took off, Willie's, but Debbie had walked right in front of that truck. She had a pink dress on. It sort of scratched the dress up a little bit. She didn't get hurt. Anyhow, it's too much to tell. I'm going to have to sit down. But I told them about those things. And they were laughing because they remembered. And I remembered how God had blessed those youngsters. Pastor John has made his arrival. And I believe the praise team is on.
Let's give the Lord a hand praise.
Thank you.
We thank God for
praise the Lord.
Encouraging words from our bishop. Amen. Said, hope thou in God. Amen.
Amen.
We have something to look forward to beyond this life. This is not our home, but we are pilgrims passing through. How many know that?
Yes.
Amen. Yes. Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a praise, a hand praise.
As always, we encourage you to worship with us. We owe God a debt of praise. Amen. I jokingly say, put something on your praise bill this week. So we encourage you to worship the Lord with us.
You deserve it. Let the river of my worship flow to you.
Just like
Like streams in the valley, they swell with the rain. Let the songs of my heart, let a rise to bless your name, flow to you.
Forever,
I'll give you glory.
Forever. Maybe we can bring in the fellowship. Give yourself a hand praise. Come on.
And read yourself a verse. Pat yourself on the back. Read back here. Give me a few pats of Bibles that David encouraged himself.
Amen.
Ain't nothing wrong with encouraging yourself. Sometimes people won't give you the praise that you need. Come on, Brother Amen. D. You ain't gonna pass it all day. You got a lot of stuff. He might miss you. So pat yourself on the back. You gotta know what you did. Amen. I don't know what you did. But God knows. The Bible says in Galatians that he is not unrighteous to forget the labors of love that we have. But Philippians 3 this morning. If you have your Bibles, you can stay seated. It's all right. God is here. We know that already. Familiar portion of Scripture. We try to touch on at least once a year. The previous chapter, verse chapter 2, is the kenosis passage. And we're going to be in chapter 3 of Philippians. Though I might have confidence in the flesh, if any other man think that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more. Circumcised the eighth day, the stock of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin, one of the elite tribes, or dedicated tribes, should I say, and Hebrew, the Hebrews. Today there are Hispanics in this country who have lost their heritage. There are African Americans who can't speak their native tongue. But Paul says, I'm a Hebrew of the Hebrews. I didn't lose my language when I got here. I didn't lose my culture. There are people who can make you authentic Mexican meals. You can go to Taco Bell, but that's not Mexican food. There are people who can make you authentic Italian food. You can go get you some ragu, but I'm not sure that is an authentic Italian. And Paul said, I'm a Hebrew of the Hebrews.
Yes.
I haven't lost my heritage. I may be dislodged from my land, but I'm not dislodged from my faith. Can I get an amen this morning? Circumcised the eighth day, the stock of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of the Hebrews, as touching the law of Pharisee. He was serious about keeping God's commandments. Anybody serious about it this morning?
Amen.
Concerning zeal, persecuting the church. What he was doing, he thought was the right thing. But you can do things that you think are right and not be pleasing to God.
Amen.
So much that he persecuted the church. Touching righteousness, which is in the law of blameless. He was not without flaw, but surely he was someone that people would look to when it come to lawful things. Okay, he had learned at the feet of Gamaliel, which was maybe the greatest teacher in the Old Testament. Concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching righteousness, which in the law. But, somebody say but.
But
what things that were gained to me, those I kind of lost for Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Look at somebody. Say, it's all about Jesus.
It's all about
Jesus.
Amen.
You may be seated. We're grateful, again, just for everyone that works in the church. And I encourage you to don't be discouraged.
Amen.
When things aren't going well or something that you have going on doesn't seem to be taking off like an airplane. Great things in life take a mind of someone who's willing to go against resistance.
Amen.
I didn't get too many amens this morning, but I know Amen. There's a few people here that have the grit that it takes to get through something. Maybe piano lessons. The world is full of folks who started piano lessons and then just quit.
Amen.
The people who, thousands of people who went to college started and quit. They thought it was going to be more than partying on the weekend.
Amen.
They didn't know that college was more than a kegger on McKinley. When I came to Ball State in 1993, almost 30 years ago, I rode down the middle of the campus and I was trying to decide what college I was going to, and I played football and had some options. But when I came to the end of McKinley, there was a man on top of a roof. If you go down to McKinley and you go south, you'll run right into a house. And the yard was filled with people, and I had maybe my older brother, uncle, my dad, or someone with me. And the man was there, the yard was full of people, and they were all partying real good. And they were stumbling and carrying on, laughing. And then on the rooftop was a man that didn't have no clothes on, and he had a beard too, and he may have been happier than anybody at the party. And I told my sister, I said, this is the college I'm gonna go to. And my dad looked at me like I had lost my mind. But I soon realized that it was more to getting a college degree than getting drunk on a rooftop.
Amen.
And in our lives and in our Christian faith, if you don't gird up the loins of your mind, if you don't prepare your mind in life in general, that good things come over time. These are things even in the confines of a church where we just let time play out.
Amen.
Where people that are not really committed will just fall off anyhow. Oh, amen. I'm preaching. I ain't mad at you this morning. And I'm just telling you the truth. The Apostle Paul was one of those people who had to just endure the time and the suffering of things that happened in the confines of a ministry. Sister Lane, faith-inspired seeds of hope, I'm certain didn't take off in a weekend. She had things that hindered her and times where she couldn't go and times where things were outside of her hand. Let me talk about myself. As a pastor, there are times when there are things that we want to do, things that we're encouraged to do by other people, but we don't have the people to do it. We don't have the resources to get it done. The vision is there, but we have to, much like Zerubbabel, who did his best to rebuild the temple, we have to mind to show up every day. The motto for this year, in case you have forgot, is no days off. So as you consider your walk with God and what that looks like, don't take any days off. Not having any days off doesn't mean you're not going to have a headache. It doesn't mean that we're going to have bills that need paid, maybe are not getting paid. But it simply means that we're going to have a mind to keep going on despite what's going on. I'm trying to help you this morning put some grit inside of you. There's an old Western movie I like. It's called True Grit. And it's about a little girl who is just determined to find her daddy's killer. And she gets him in the end. But she had something inside of her that wouldn't let obstacles stop her. If we're going to use you at the church, somebody say me, you have to have a mind to go on despite things that are troublesome in your life. And that is a good practice. Even outside of this church, when we're dealing with the things and we want to accomplish, and maybe you're making a business, maybe you're in a relationship, you're surely going to have to mind to get past the trouble areas. There are going to be arguments some days. There are going to be disagreements some days. Some days, it ain't even necessarily spiritual warfare. Some days, I just got a headache, D. It's a natural problem. But whatever it is, I have to have a mind to keep going. Keep going, keep pursuing. And we have something, as Apostle Paul ran into, that was able to keep him from going when he was perplexed, as he said, when he was with despair. We have the power of the Holy Spirit. The same Spirit that filled this place during worship does more than just show up when we're together praising the Lord. We know that God loves the communion of his people. This here at church is not you at home on a Sunday in front of a TV watching the televangelist. No, God likes the communion of his people together. If you go back to the very beginning of the Bible, he put some folks together to bring him glory. Adam and Eve and Cain and Abel, and that family was designed long before the church to bring glory to God. Husband might love his wife, wife might honor and respect her husband, and the kids might bring glory in their ways by being obedient and such. But when we look back into the unity that God has put together, even in the nation of Israel, he found one nation, a group of people he wanted to be tied together in unity, not pursuing their own ways, but together in love, one people. The Bible lets us know that those same people were not the strongest of the nations. He says, in juxtaposition, in controversy, they were the smallest. They were the weakest. They didn't have many horses or many chariots, but yet God used them in a mighty way. If they could just have a mind to stay together. A long time ago, there was a man named Al Green that wrote a song called, "Let's Stay Together." And that should be the motto for the church. Let's just stay together, church. Whatever we go through, there's no big eyes and there's no little U's in the church. One cannot say to the other, we don't have need of thee, but we all have something that supplies the church. Amen. Nevertheless, we get started here. We look at someone who, it would seem to me, the Apostle Paul, that would have reasonable accommodations for his life. A lot of times when we look at someone who is a leadership in ministry, we assume certain things that they might have, but everyone in ministry does not own a business. Everyone in ministry is not rich. It's not the way God's kingdom work. There are a lot of times you're a child of God and you have lack, Brother D. I spend majority of my life going paycheck to paycheck. And it didn't mean I was less of a child of God because I didn't have anything. The Bible lets us know that the love of money is the root of all evil. And while men chase after it, they erred from the faith. Don't let your pursuit of money take you away from the will of God. The Bible says, but godliness with contentment is great gain. Hallelujah. If you just learn to trust God, money can't satisfy all your needs. Things can't satisfy all your needs. People can't satisfy. But if you just have a mind to keep God at the forefront of your life, despite the troubles that you face and the things that you go through, you'll find that He'll keep you in perfect peace. Hallelujah. In times of trouble, God will keep you. But reasonable accommodations have not been made for the apostle and as he writes to the Philippians. Remember that it's this time. He is writing when he is in prison. He's not in prison for running red lights or whatever they had then. He's in prison for preaching the gospel. We don't want to go to jail and think we're giving God glory by starting a riot or being a part of a mob. That's not what we're going to bring out of the text. But he is actually in jail for preaching the gospel. In a Roman jail, a dirt cell, not like the jails we have today where they have electricity and things, but life is put him in an uncomfortable situation. God's man, God's woman, in an uncomfortable situation that is pleasing to God. Ooh, that right there will preach. There are times in your life when you are in an uncomfortable situation, dying to get out of this mess, and God is getting glory out of your life. Hallelujah. And you'll just have to deal with that on a personal basis. But let me tell you what, God often puts us in uncomfortable situations. He likes it. The Bible says whatever happens, God delights in our way. In light of the circumstances that Paul was in, he wanted to share something with the Philippian church. In a rough place, in a rough time in his life, probably questioning maybe at times his ministry, because we think that people in the Bible soar on a cloud. But I have to think that when he tells us to be anxious for nothing, that in his own mind he's trying to work out anxiety. Nero is looking to kill him. He's not sure if he's going to get free or his life is going to come to a drastic end. So a lot of times when we're encouraging other people, we're just giving them what we're going through ourselves. Come on, somebody. In order to be a blessing to the body of Christ, you have to have a mind to go no days off. Despite how you feel, despite how you are troubled, despite the external circumstances that seek to overthrow our faith, we have to have a mind to keep on going. Come on, somebody say, keep on going. In the name of Jesus. Say, keep on going. In the name of Jesus. Paul has a mind to keep on going. Despite the external circumstances that has changed his life.
Amen.
In all that we do, the Bible says that the Lord works everything for our good.
Amen.
You, church, have to remember that today.
Yes,
even
yes.
As people who are being sanctified, that the things that you think God ought to remove, God is working it all for your good.
Yes.
I work in manufacturing, and it's just rough some days. Labor is not there. The manpower is there. The processes aren't all what they're supposed to be. And some of y'all know you've worked in manufacturing or at a bank or wherever you work. Sometimes everything ain't what it's supposed to be. But we find out that despite all the arguments and the firings and the moving around, the management and different things, that we find out at the end of the year that the report said that the revenue was up 15%. And the people who are on hire, just thankful. We may not see it through the course of the year, but those who are on the up and higher up are saying, just keep on going. Amen. Look at somebody say, just keep on going. Say things are working out just how God wants them to work out. You just keep on going. Amen. Sometimes we don't realize what the common goal is in a family, in a church, in a ministry. We think it's all about us. But it's not all about us.
Amen.
It's all about Jesus.
Amen.
If you are a Christian and you're seeking to be pleasing to God,
amen,
you have to know that the internal fights that we have are producing an outer glory. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians, I believe 4 and 17, that our light afflictions, which are just for a moment,
yes,
produce a far more exceeding, yes, and eternal weight of glory.
Yes.
Paul understands this. He wrote it by revelation of Jesus Christ. Paul understands, as we read, that he understands the dynamics of ministry. Did you know that gospel ministry has a dynamic to it? And here it is. Are you ready? Here are the dynamics to gospel ministry. Some people preach Christ out of envy. Some people come to church with envy in their heart. Some people are looking for a rivalry. Even in the context of a ministry, some people think this is a rivalry. Well, before you start feeling bad about the church, there are people in a marriage that are rivalrous. There are brothers and sisters that have sibling rivalry. There are always a discourse at times in the confines of God trying to produce unity. Paul says, some preach Christ. I want you to understand this, church. This is not a letter to pastors. This is a letter to the church. So you understand the dynamics of what's happening inside of the church. That some people are not here for the right intentions. And I'm not talking about this church. I'm talking about the big church. Everywhere we go. Okay? He says, the latter, some preach it out of goodwill. There are people within the church who are simply trying to do good. And hopefully that's you this morning. The latter, he says, do so out of love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel.
Amen.
He says the former preach Christ out of selfish ambition. We don't want to be there. He says in opposition, not sincerely, a heart that is seeking to please God and to forward his purposes,
yes,
has removed selfish ambition from their heart. Sometimes that requires tough decisions.
Amen.
As a child of God, as a woman helping her husband lead a family, or even a single man or a single woman, you have to make tough decisions.
Yes.
Tough decisions.
Yes.
But you understand that those decisions are what's best for the greater good.
Yes.
Not that you dislike anyone. Not that we don't want to confront people. Rebuke is not what we have at the forefront. But even through God's word, we find things in his word that rebuke us, not necessarily the pastor, the preacher, or even someone who loves you. But we understand the rebuke is good. Paul understands this, though they preach out of selfish ambition, and some not sincerely, supposing they can stir up trouble while he is in chains. He says people preach for all kind of reasons. People serve for all kind of reasons. Learn to serve God independent of the perspectives and the advantages of other people.
Amen.
I'm just going to teach you a little bit this morning.
Amen.
Learn to serve God, church, irrespective of what someone else is doing. We have one particular person, and I won't say their name, but when they come, a lot of times when they're cleaning, their head is almost down. They're just here to do the work and get the work done, and their focus, and a lot of times, as a manager at work, someone will come up and say, did you see such and such? She didn't have her glasses on. Are you going to do anything about that? And then at the same time, I say, you're out of your workspace. So I want both of y'all to come up here. In the church, it's no different. We have to have a mind to do God's work, irrespective of what other people are doing. Years ago, I heard a pastor say that he knew something was going on wrong in the church. And there were people may have encouraged him to address the situation, but God told him to just let it go. We have, even as Christians, as pastors, we have a higher authority that we answer to. And sometimes that higher authority doesn't say, go get anybody. It says, leave it alone and let it play out and I'll work it out. Why? Because it's not always about me. It's always about Jesus and what Jesus wants. What I found out is his yoke is easy and that his burden is light. He implores us to come unto him. All ye are weary and heavy laden, and he'll give you rest. I see why he wants us to come to him. Because God is not like men. We don't do anything out of selfish ambition. If things are to be about Jesus, if his church is to grow, if we, our ministries are to grow, we always have to consider the fact that we have a common goal to please God. He said, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain deceit, but in opposition, here it is, in humility, consider other people even better than yourself. That didn't mean they're better, First Lady. It means I'm considering you better. That means that I will let you have the shot at front seat, Brother D. How tall are you? 6'4"? His legs are longer. He's got big feet. I'm going to let him sit up there. He ain't better than me, but I'm considering him better than me. Amen. That's a good teacher. The world honors intelligent, beautiful, rich people. But we should honor people who give their lives in Christ's sake. Amen. We do not judge people on how they look. You can go get those long lashes that curl up back over your head. But they won't help you here at church. That we honor people because God honors people who give their life to Christ's work. So a lot of times we're looking for people to do something because our direction and our goal and aim has dropped. But you need to lift your head back up and keep your eyes on God. Amen. Stop looking to people to satisfy all your needs and to fulfill everything that your heart desires. There is a God-filled hole that only God can fill. The pastor can't fill it. The husband can't fill it. The wife can't. The kids, the ministry, the job, the money. Nothing you can have can fill that hole until you say, Lord, you take your place on the throne of my life. Because it's all about Jesus. From the first glance at the text, it would seem as we read through that Paul is bragging about his religious past. We've got to be careful about that. But what he is actually doing is the opposite. He is showing you that there were a lot of good things in the Old Testament that God wanted them to do, and he did his best to keep them. Yes. Today, there is this idea that I'm spiritual and not religious. Those things never go together in any facet of life, spiritual but not religious. I love you, but I don't do nothing for you. Amen. Hold up. That is not how life works. Faith without works is dead, being alone, just as the body without the spirit is dead. And our religious dedication and our duty, the zeal that Paul talks about, which was clearly important, I say it's the greatest attribute of a Christian in the Old Testament and the New. Remember, he said, what I received by grace. He said, but I labored more than everyone. You could say you got grace, but how much of that grace has backed up by your work in the kingdom of God? Now, that's a question for you to ask yourself. But we usually consider, he said, I put no confidence in the flesh. We usually consider dead works of our past, things like sexual misconduct, or what Paul calls the acts of the flesh. Remember, in Galatians 5:19 through 21, now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, being divisive in the church. And we've been talking in Bible study about our mouths, and we can come into the church and talk about people. We preach it here, and at the same time we're preaching, we're doing the exact same thing. So we need to guard our minds and our hearts to not be divisive through what we say. I touched last week that just because it's true don't mean you need to say it. I've got things in my life, brother, that are true, but I don't want nobody to say it. There are things in our past that are true, But I don't want you to say it. You're in my church. You're my brother. You know better. You're my sister. You know better. You don't have to say it. There are things about your present that are true that you don't want nobody to say. And there's things in the future that are coming down the pipeline that are true, but you don't want anybody to say. Paul says these acts, dissensions, divisions, he goes on envious, drunkenness, things like these. He says, I warned you before that those that do these things do not inherit the kingdom of God. I consider, do you believe him? Because a heart that is seeking God, there were 12 disciples. One of them was right there. He had the name, he had the title, he had the opportunity, but his heart was not set on God. The Bible said those that do those things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. It's never an outward thing. A lot of times in our minds, we can be struggling with something. We can be in a struggle, and our hearts are headed up toward God. We may not have the wisdom to get out of something. It may not be the time, because even struggles have their set time to take their course. Yes. Oh, yeah. We don't get to, like a child, cry and say, I've had enough. Not with God. No chastening for the moment seems joyous but grievous, Hebrews 12. But afterwards, it produces the peaceable fruit of righteousness. Yes. If you just let God have his way, he'll work it out. Amen. Okay. But the Bible lets us know that these people that do these things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Paul was a man who had a lot to boast. His credentials, his background, his upbringing, his nationality. He had a good family background. You know, some of us got some family members that we wish would just stay off the radar. Amen. We wish we could just give them another last name. But he had a good background. His family had good sense. That's a hard thing to find. But his conversion, he lets us know that this new life that he found was not based upon any of his past, any of his keeping of God's commandments. That his new life that he found, that he says he counted those old things as dung. And do you know what dung is? Dung is manure. He said all of my religious acts, all the things that I thought was pleasing to God, he said, I now count them as dumb, because even locked up in our religious duty is selfish ambition. Oh, yeah. God is able to look past the external and into our heart and ask, why are we doing what we're doing? Not just what we're doing, because giving money is good. Remember Ananias and Sapphira in the book of Acts. They gave money, but it was clear that they were just doing it for looks. They didn't give it out of the right heart. They gave a portion. They lied about what they give. They didn't have to give it, because God is always concerned about our heart. Remember when he dealt with David, he said, God does not look on the outside, but he looks at the heart. Amen. Because we don't know exactly what is going on in the hearts of my sister and the heart of my brother. The Bible says the Spirit in Romans 8 searches all things, the deep things of God. The Holy Spirit can search your heart. He can understand what's in your heart, what your heart needs. Paul understood that this family background, this education, all these credentials, his title of whatever it was in the Old Testament, I guess what we could call it, the church, not really the church, but in the priesthood, that he had a lot to brag about. But when he met Jesus on the Damascus Road, he said something changed in his life. Something has changed in his life. He didn't tell him. He chose him because of his excellent religious past. It wasn't his moral excellence that God chose Saul. But on the contrary, he told him and asked him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? You're doing all these religious things in my name, and at the same time, you're persecuting me. How do I persecute God when I'm trying my best to come pleasing to him, when you're hurting other Christians? Amen. We got two amens back. When you're hurting other Christians in the name of the Lord. Because the greatest law is to love your brother and to love God. So we can't make excuses through the word of God while I'm destroying my brother's character, while I'm breaking my sister down. That's not going to work in church. He said when Christ met him with this huge banner of credentials and education and religious background and even a strong moral past, the man was solid morally. No, no, it didn't work. Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?
Yes, yes.
This morning, I may not have the excellent past, the Apostle Paul. I can't boast to having a strong, my father was a pastor, but most of us don't have a strong religious past like that. We may be able to hit mama and grandpa, but we stopped there. But he had an excellent past, but we don't have this. But this morning, I want you to consider that whatever it is that you've hung your hat on from a religious standpoint, that this morning, from this day forward, you'll count it as done. Because coming to God and working in his kingdom is not about me. It's not about how many titles I can get or what I can boast and brag about. It's not about going to church and say I've got 42 consecutive Sundays that I've been to church. That's not what it's about. You may have grown up this morning on the wrong side of the tracks. You may have grown up on a place where a lot of people didn't go. Relationships in your life may have not have worked, but God told me to tell you this morning, it don't matter. This morning, it is all about Jesus Christ. Whatever it is, good or bad, I want you to refocus. You know, a lot of times we got to squint our eyes. I want you to refocus this morning and consider that God sent his son, this is the gospel now, so that you might have life. That he might not take your old life and clean it up and shine it. But he said, if you lose your life, you'll gain a life. Whatever it was that you want to brag about this morning, you can leave it at the door. It's all about Jesus this morning. And I found out when I get away from that old yoke of the law that keeps telling me, you still lie sometimes. You still stole a pen occasionally. But when I yoke up with Jesus, the Bible says his yoke is easy. His burden is light. We have favor and grace and love when we come to the Lord. The songwriter says, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. I wonder if we got two or three people this morning that say, it's all about Jesus this morning. Oh, it's all about Jesus. I got issues this morning, but it's all about Jesus Christ. I'm going to lay my heavy burdens down. Whatever's weighing your mind now, set it on down. Kick it on out the way and say, I serve a Savior that is greater than my problems. I serve a God that sent his son to be the atoning sacrifice for my sin. The devil is a liar. I will not listen to the accuser of the brethren. I'll lift up my eyes to the hills from which cometh my help. Can I get a hallelujah this morning? Can I get a thank you, Jesus, this morning? Oh, it's not by works this morning, but it is by the sacrifice of his son. Paul said this, forgetting those things which are behind. And until you forget the stuff you did and all how you impressed such and such or how you failed God, until the mature Christian Spurgeon says, neither exalts himself or debases himself.
Amen.
His vision has went from self to Christ.
Amen. Amen.
I'm no longer judging myself.
Amen.
I was judged one time.
Hallelujah.
At the cross. Where I first saw the light, come on, in the burdens of my heart, go away. It was there by faith. I received my sight, and now I am happy. Oh, sometimes trying to live the perfect Christian life can be so difficult that it leaves you feeling drained, zapped. But we can feel so far from God that we feel we can never please him. But God wanted me to encourage you today that we have all done things that we're ashamed of. And we often live in a tension of what we were and what we want to be.
Oh, yes.
Most of us and many of us live our lives crucified between two thieves, just like Jesus. Yeah. But you know you can't be Jesus. The guilt of the past and the worry of the future. But you can't be Jesus. You can't be him. He bore all our sins himself.
I'm here to tell you that it's not about you. What we do, we get inside a church and that's Shayla. It's not about you.
Amen.
It's not about your inability to be perfect.
Amen.
He already did it one time.
Yes.
That's gospel. That's Greek for good news.
Yes.
Sometimes people come in and say, you want the good news, bad, or the bad news, Brother King, good or bad? And you scratch your head and say, I don't know. I don't want no bad news. There's no bad news in the gospel.
Yes.
It's good news.
Yes.
And when you share that good news, it transforms people's lives.
Amen.
You can get in the top 10 on the index for the stock, and you may be able to help somebody invest their money, but nothing will change a life and a heart and turn around a family and a community like the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
And you can try to send somebody off to some school and get them an education. But let me tell you what, some of the most wicked people in this country got high education. Because education ain't the answer. Some of the foulest people in this country are in the halls of Congress. But when the gospel comes, Jesus promised the restoration and there were times of refreshing. When he would change a person's heart. Get up on the inside. Paul said, what things was gained to me? Those I counted lost when I met Jesus. And what happens is you find out that you start giving people grace around you. You say, oh, normally I would have really lit him up. But then you think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for you. And then you say, oh, yeah. I think I'll give you a pass. That's why in our prayers we say, forgive me my debts as I forgive my debtors. It's supposed to be a constant exchange. What we do is say, forgive me. And God is saying, what about him? Because you're still mad at him. So you need to make an exchange this way while you're making the exchange this way. It's a good dance. You're going to have to try that at church. When you're going up, make sure you're going out. When you're asking for mercy, make sure you're extending mercy. The Bible says we ought to forgive one another in Colossians as Christ forgave you. A lot of us, we come to church on a weekly basis with no mind to forgive whatsoever. Or we even write down stuff we'll be mad about. I ain't forgetting this. God's people.
Amen.
But I want to encourage you and remind you today, this is not about you.
Amen.
This church, this ministry, and any ministry is about the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The Bible says the church is built upon that foundation, and Jesus Christ is the chief cornerstone.
Hallelujah.
That means everything falls apart without him.
Amen.
And I'll tell you what, as beautiful as heaven is will be, and the Bible talks about the 12 foundations that the apostles named, not 13 apostles, not 50 apostles, 12. And when we get up there, we see the streets of gold that are gold is so pure you can see through it. Nothing will be as all-inspiring as seeing the Lord himself.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. When I see Jesus, amen. Our hearts have something to look forward to. We have a day of restoration and refreshing coming. Isaiah said, every mountain shall be, a valley shall be exalted. Every mountain, what he's trying to say is God's going to fix everything. It won't be no more shoulder aches. Won't be no glaucoma. Won't be no retinal surgery. And won't be no canes in glory. Hallelujah. Won't be no oxygen tank.
Hallelujah.
We're going to have a new body. The Bible says we're going to take flight up out of here one day. The dead in Christ shall rise. But those that are dead shall remain and remain shall meet them in the cloud. What a great hope and expectation that we have. You know, Paul said it's in this life only we have hope. We have to have a mind that I'm working here, but I'm working toward a reward. You know, an eternal a reward that can't be removed, it can't be shaken, that is yours now. The Bible said it's yours now, not later. So we have to have a mind to say, okay, so it's really not about me. It's about Jesus Christ. When you don't want to get up in the morning, remember, it ain't about you. This is about someone else that God wants you to encounter with and be a blessing to. We struggle when we stop thinking about the big plan. Internally in the manufacturing place, we struggle when we stop realizing that at the end of February, we're getting a profit share. That we have made billions of dollars. And that all of those little small arguments about stuff that didn't make no sense, we've been all blessed. Our families are blessed. We're blessed.
Thank you, Jesus.
But a lot of times the internal struggle
yes.
keeps us from seeing the goodness of God. Yes. Let's give God a hand, praise. Yes. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. I thank the Lord
Amen.
For all he's done in my life personally.
Amen.
Let's prepare to give. Brother D, would you come? Brother Kent, could you come and help with the giving this morning?
Amen.
Father, say God loves a cheerful giver. You should give as God has prospered you.
Yes.
If you didn't get paid last week, I don't know what you're going to give. We thank God that if you was prospered, we ask him to give. Thank God for each and every giver of this church. Those who have given just not only their money, but give of their time. People who sweep and clap, clean the church. We thank God for you. We thank God for everybody who has given their time. Okay, you can come at this time. That's good.
Trouble don't last always.
Amen.
We have a God that's faithful. Amen.
Amen.
Thank God for the word of God. We appreciate hearing the word that gets us through. That's our encouragement for the week. We can eat on that and feast on that all week long.
Amen.
I do want to encourage each and every one of you to come out to Bible study every Wednesday at 6 p.m. Our pastor said that if you want to be a part of the planning committee, things that we have up and coming, please come out. It will be a meeting after Bible study on Wednesday of this week. Amen.
Amen.
Sunday morning service. We have service here at 10 a.m.
Amen.
Invite someone. Every first Saturday of each month, our pastor had a vision to have a breakfast for the community. So come out, serve, volunteer, give, donate, whatever you can do. If you can't do any of those things, just pray for us. Amen. It's growing. It's getting better. We have fun. We have a good time. Amen.
Amen.
So come every third Thursday of each month. We have Her Story for His Glory, where women come and gather and support each other and just listen to the testimonies of how women have overcome obstacles, trauma, issues, pain, whatever it is. It doesn't have to be anything major as far as abuse, but maybe they overcame an accident, a health issue. Amen? But whatever it is, come out and listen and support and give of your time. Amen? That's this month coming up on the 19th from 6 to 7 here at Berea. Am I forgetting anything, Pastor? I think that's all, at least for now. If you have any questions or any issues, please see one of us. We love you. God bless you. And we're going to turn it back in the hands of our pastor. Let's receive him by saying amen.
Amen. Our coffee, the coffee bar just takes up one room. If you have something from a ministry standpoint, we've got rooms all on the other side of waiting for somebody.
Amen.
And the Lord put it on my heart that we should probably have a room for with clothes so people can come and be able to pick some clothes out. So if somebody wants a ministry, pastor just found one for you. Pick a room. We'll get some racks in there and put clothes in there so families can come and look through and pick out something for free. Is that okay?
Amen.
Okay, just get with me if you want to pick that mantle up. We've got plenty of space. So to whom much is given, much is required. But we want to try to get busy. Anything else, anyone have a need, make sure you come and see us at the church. Sister Candace, so good to see you. God bless you. All right, let's stand. Everyone with uplifted hands, let the words of my mouth, and the meditation in my heart, be acceptable on thy sight. O Lord, my strength, my redeemer. Tell someone you love them.
Caffeine is
coffee. No, I was saying hopefully not half eaten.
Oh, no.